This is the reality show on Calabash TV.
Oh, pirates, yes, they rob us. Sold I to the merchant ship. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pits, but my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We fought in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help me sing?
How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing another song of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had, redemption song.
August 1st in St. Lucia, 2017, we joined the world in celebrating Emancipation Day in St. Lucia. And there was a panel discussion organized by the Cultural Development Foundation, the CDF, to commemorate that occasion. And that panel discussion looked at our economic and political freedom, whether we were emancipated politically and economically. And joining us in the studio here today, we have with us, first of all, we want to start from our extreme right, Dr. King, Stephen King. Dr. King, you were in the audience. We'll talk a little bit about your involvement there. And you did, so you witnessed the panel discussion as well. And we also have, to my immediate left, Lucius Doxerie Jr., yeah. Was a human resource specialist.
Yeah, peace and love, man.
Oh, Lucius, welcome. Your name is familiar to quite a few of us because that's a story they want to tell right now.
Yeah, it's all good. It's okay, man.
Yeah, it's all good. So we know of your father. He's a media personality as well. So and he's a very good friend of ours here at Calabash TV. And we have Wasar Hiru Maat. Did I get it right?
Yes.
And you are from the Ethiopia World Federation Chaplain. You're the chaplain?
Yes, I'm the chaplain.
For St. Lucia?
Ethiopian World Federation local in St. Lucia.
Now, I'm very curious about the Ethiopian World Federation. Can you give us a brief background into it?
Sure. It was founded by His Imperial Majesty Emperor Haile Selassie I. He sent Dr. Maleku Bayen to New York to set up the Ethiopian World Federation. It was after the occurrence of the war, which started in 1936, and it lasted till 1941 with the Italians attacking the Ethiopians. It was the Italians trying to get a piece of Africa in that great scramble for Africa. So it was set up then to unify Africans throughout the world, not only for Ethiopia, but at that time Ethiopianism meant the entire continent of Africa. So it's actually a pan-African entity, only for African people. I don't like to use the word African descendant, because for me the European is a African descendant.
Cool. We'll certainly have to have a few more sessions with you to talk a little bit more about that, because we know that from what you've just said, there's quite a lot for us to unwrap in this. And Dr. King, I said earlier that you were at the discussion.
Yes, I was.
I was anticipating that you would have said a thing or two. you didn't. And no. I guess that's why we had you here, because I need to hear from Dr. King at some point in time.
Well, thank you very much, Bernard. Well, I was listening. Because there's a certain discontent that's rising in me with the same old, same old. And yes, the right words are said, but the movement is not there. I think it ended, as I said, on a good note with Jomo. When Jomo essentially gave a call to arms and to action, because I think we are losing ourselves, or maybe we've even lost ourselves and need to find ourselves again. One of the things that struck me was, and some of the sound bites that keep on coming back that disempower us, and one that really jarred me, was the whole concept that we were given our emancipation by the Europeans, namely the British, when it comes to St. Lucia. And that really offended me, because we were never given emancipation. And in fact, because, well, on a philosophical note, you can argue that we still are not emancipated, right, and we will come to that. But on a more, even more practical note, St. Lucians fought from the time of the Amerindian, the Kalinago peoples, we fought for our to be free and to remain free. And the Amerindian people were annihilated and assimilated. And thereafter, the African fought from the Brigon Wars, from before the Brigon Wars, in fact, we fought. And this, the history of St. Lucian people and slavery is not one of accepting slavery until the emancipation. It was a constant battle. And if you read the history books of all General Moore and them who spoke about fighting the brigands, as they call them, who are really freedom fighters, resistance fighters in the hills, our ancestors who fought, he will tell you, or you will read him saying that he had great respect for these people and the way that they could stand and fight. And I think that we, that jarred me more than anything else, because I don't want to tell my children, and I don't want us to tell our children, that they were just weak people who were given freedom. No, that is not true. That's far from the truth. And it's about time we start telling our own history or our own stories to our children. These are the memes, as we call them, the memes that we pass on to our children, those cultural values and units that propagate down the generations for the generations yet to come. We must pass these memes on in a manner in which our youth are empowered and understand they have the confidence to face this world eye to eye with anybody, no matter what society, class, creed, color, race, or whatever they come from, or whatever they are. That, I think, is so important, because we are disempowering our youth by not giving them the right memes to go forward with, the right cultural values, the right history, the right understanding. And it translates into a lot of things, because tourism was spoken about as well. And our politicians negotiate deals on behalf of us, and they don't understand the value of us and the land when these deals are being done. When you come to a negotiating table, you come to a negotiating table with a consciousness of the value of yourself, your people, and your land. And this is one of the reasons why I think many times you find you have sellouts, or what we consider to be sellouts, and it is time to stop all that. And I think it starts by educating our children in the manner that they're supposed to be educated.
That's one of the things we want to discuss today, in terms of what can be done as of now, because we know what the issues are, we know what needs to be done. I think that's well articulated, and we'll hear some of it today. But the key thing for me and the purpose of this program is, what are the smallest things that you can do now to start changing it? Because it's not going to be changed overnight. It calls for a revolutionary change, but it's going to start with a very, very small micro step. Before I get to our other panelists, I wanted to play Dr. King. You are familiar with what happened at the panel discussion, but for the purposes of our guests as well, I wanted to give them a feel of what went on in terms of the panel discussion. Now, it's not capturing everything that was said. In the interest of time, without time to play everything, but let me give you a feel of what the panelists had to offer.
When you speak about economic freedom and you tag tourism to it, it begs the question, to what extent can tourism as our major industry provide a platform for economic freedom for our people? Tourism is a sector which is linked to the global economy. We know of the vulnerabilities of the tourism sector. We know of the potential as well. But at the same time, if it is the sector that has to determine the priorities for our people, then clearly we have to think the extent to which it is integrated into other sectors in our economy and our society.
For me, I approach that topic by saying to myself that independence is the right that a nation state has to decide for itself. It is also the right to decide to be dependent. So for me, the notion of words like independence are synonymous with words like emancipation. And I look at that in the context of a small economy that, by virtue of its openness, will always be interdependent.
So now that we're looking at tourism, which is important in the dead center of our economy, an economy linked to politics, it does beg the question, and we know that a lot of persons are of the opinion that our tourism industry is like enslavement. Let's get that on the table, that most persons do assume that. We have the likes of our own Derek Walcott mentioning in his poetry the illusion of our own economy being the same cycle of enslavement and being dependent on the foreign European power. So this, of course, probes my thinking into how far into tourism are we exactly going? Is our country just focused on hotel tourism, or are we looking into other sectors, which is also very important? And I think that that should be a leading question moving forward in how we approach the topic of emancipation, tourism, politics, and economics.
Very timely, based on the narrative, the prevailing narrative for the last 6 months, some of the challenges with the potential investment opportunities and hard decisions. When I think of tourism, I think of 1492. Maybe that was our first tourism. Was it invasion or investment? Politics, when I think of politics, I think of two Latin words, poly and tix, many bloodsuckers. And economic freedom might be a bit of an illusion in this global dispensation, because we do have the new colonialists that are knocking on our doors. So very timely, these three words. But as a nation, to really have an open discussion, the narrative must change. And the narrative must first start with the politicians, because that is where the art of governance comes from.
So here we have a little sampling of the discussion that happened. We couldn't play everything, but we'll get a few more sound bites from the panel. But I'll start with you, Maat, and we heard Kerber Didi talking about changing the narrative. Now, he did mention it has to start with the politicians. Do you agree with him?
I think it would definitely need to start with self. It needs to start with every individual person. Embrace that person in the mirror. Learn who that person is. Learn the foundation of who you are. Get priority. Learn what is important. Learn to love the family. Our nation is in problems. This is because our families are in problems. Why is that? We have to go down into the subliminal messages of religion, which handicap us from making any moves to do anything, because we keep expecting a savior to come and save us, when indeed we asked for a savior and the ancestors sent us. So I look into the cause rather than the effect. Our traumatized, disconnected spirits. And how do we heal? The European psychologists cannot heal us, as the traumatic experience of the slave trade was not taken into account to investigate the African psyche. So they are useless and powerless. We really need to address our unity. Politics seems to be a divider more than a unifier. Religion seems to be a divider more than a unifier. Capitalism, which is class, is a divider and not a unifier. So how do we overcome those barriers and unite the people? In unity, it is the only way we can fight what is happening in our island. The government are, of course, the same product of our societies. We expect them to be greater people than us ourselves. Why not want them to be just as we are, or would they be too vile? We need to first change and build our characters. And the question of culture in St. Lucia. Culture has been placed on a nationality and not a genetical, ethnicity of the people. And I think that's a big problem, because St. Lucian history is very short and it's drenched in slavery, and it's one of our falls in our civilization. But we have great, great, great civilizations. Let's talk about Nubia, let's talk about Kemet, let's talk about Ethiopia, let's talk about Senegal, Burkina Faso, Guinea, let's talk about Africa. And from them we can get the culture, because we can all see that the Eurocentric education we're receiving, the media, everything is working against that unifying effort that so many come and try to do and establish, but they never succeed because we need the leaders involved. We need the government, the prime ministers, we need the Ministry of Education, we need them involved. We no longer should we be teaching our children about Sir Walter Raleigh, Francis Drake's, you know, Queen Elizabeth II. We need to know our history. What about the greats? We have Sir Arthur Lewis. Sir Arthur Lewis is not just remembered for his economics. He was also one of the leading Pan-Africanists of his time. We need to bring back the names of Edward John Quinlan, who was is a St. Lucian, a land surveyor who went up at the first Pan-African Congress on the heels of the scramble of Africa in 1884, when they came together and divided up Africa with not one African state present. At that time, Ethiopia was independent. Ethiopia was never colonized. So we need to teach our history, and we need to get a center. I would say an African-centered, because a Eurocentric or European-centered life leaves you to capitalize on your fellow man, as that is the foundation.
Yeah. Julius, you heard from some of the panelists at the CDF Emancipation Discussion. What stood out for you in that soundbite?
Well, what stood out, basically, I mean, I would like to share some of the sentiments, you know. I don't think that the tourism sector is an empowering industry for young people of St. Lucia. I think we should focus more on character. We should focus on learning skills where we could move into being innovative.
But who has to do that for us?
Well, it starts with us waking up and taking some accountability for where we are in our lives rather than always blaming. Because I understand the atrocities that has been done to us and the psychological damage, but we really need to take a look at ourselves in the mirror, reassess our values, and of course, it takes all stakeholders, not just ourselves, because with the resources that we have presently, we might not be able to get to where we want to be in life, you understand? But I believe if it's a collective effort to help create that communal vibe where we no longer make everything about just me, that's the capitalist mentality. Okay, so definitely education we need to have education reform in order for that, even for us to awake. We need we need to get into touch with historical fact about ourselves prior to slavery. Okay, we need to understand the role models that were there, because if your history starts with slavery, I mean, who do you really look up to say, okay, somebody of color, somebody who looks like me, who do I look up to? Because my history is from slavery. So that's already, it's breaking down my self-image, it's breaking down my self-confidence and my self-esteem. So unless I get in touch with some historical data, factual historical data about myself and how my people lived before slavery, I think unless we get in touch with that type of historical information, we will be doomed to industries like tourism. Because when you look at the tourism sector, we have the most basic unit of any society, which is the family. We have these people working on a shift system. We no longer have extended families. We've gone into the nuclear family and maybe even single parents and that sort of thing. And then when we push for tourism alone, when the mother is at work from 3 to 11, who's with the child? So tourism is, you know, like one of the sectors that can go along with other things, but it shouldn't, in my humble opinion, it shouldn't be the main focus for any St. Lucian right now. Thank you.
You know, and Bernard, I'll come in there and say, see, a lot of it depends on how you perceive and how we define this tourism industry that we want. What type of tourism industry do we want? And that is, if the tourism industry we're presently promoting is one that we have adopted without us having us defining it and saying, if we want a tourism industry which looks like this, that meets our needs, that helps, that meets our environmental needs, meets our family needs, meets our other needs. I was listening to Gaston Brown talking just recently, and we need leaders who begin to define and don't just accept everything that a tourist developer, a foreign developer, is going to put on the table. And so I think, and that kind of confidence in our negotiations is what is lacking. That's what I was alluding to in terms of us being able to sit, define, and then define what we want and then negotiate for what we want, how we want tourists to interface, how we want the tourism industry to work in our country, how do we want our beaches to be used or not used as we see fit. It is, these are the things that we need to do, and I have not heard that kind of discussion. I keep on hearing we must give the concessions because if we don't, they'll go to Antigua or whatever. That is not the way to negotiate a tourism industry in our country, in
but
my
how,
view.
How do we influence the negotiators? How do we give them the right information to negotiate on our behalf? How do we do that?
I think we do that in a number of ways. And I think it is time for St. Lucian society to become a lot stronger in a number of ways. One, our leaders themselves are merely reflections of us. So what we perceive as their weakness is really our weakness looking back at us. So I have to agree with Maat that it starts with us as each individual taking that responsibility to do our own self-development, our own self-reflection, and come to a better conscious understanding of who we are, what we stand for, and what we are as St. Lucians, St. Lucian identity. So with that, I think automatically we then find leaders would begin to mirror what we then understand. So that's step one. I think also we need to have a stronger civil society movement. So we have various civil society organizations. I think these organizations must educate themselves. So let's say it's RISE, for instance. RISE has a responsibility to educate itself and the people that listen to RISE and follow RISE. We have a responsibility to educate those people so that they can then make demands and hold leaders accountable to what is necessary in as we move forward in whatever negotiations. Take, for instance, I mean, people talk about I think it's a Viewfort Concerned Citizens Coalition, who are talking about the DSH development. That's a civil society organization which is expressing itself and its feelings about a particular development. That is important. Because if our people are going to if we're going to be the strong society that we're talking of, we need civil society organizations such as that to express themselves, to make the point, so that the negotiation, not necessarily the development, but the negotiation of that development could be a much more beneficial, mutually beneficial arrangement that enhances the lives of our people. I think that's where we go.
Yeah, because trying to figure out, we don't speak to each other. So, for example, the coalition will not be speaking to the government. Mm-hmm. So how do we bridge this divide? Because it must start with a conversation. I know they can protest, they can articulate the views. The politicians will articulate their views as well. And so you have the two divides there, the divide here. How do we bridge that gap? Because part of it is the conversation. We're not having that conversation.
Anybody can.
Well, I think this happens because of motives and agendas. Mm-hmm. An agenda having to do with my personal gain. And this is what that prevents the collective coming together to be that strong, united push against the establishment or the capitalistic idea that, you know, the fittest of the fittest survive.
But why does it have to be an encounter with the establishment? Well, is there some kind of coexistence, some kind of...
Currently, mm-hmm. It is obviously clear that the government more and more is creating that divide through all the victimization and what is going currently with the present administration. There is a lot of talk of revolution, but I want to tell my people that revolution starts with the mind. We need to go back and take those jewels from the past. There are jewels. We need to take them and polish them up because they served our ancestors for thousands and thousands of years and it worked. We had civilizations. We gave civilizations to the world. So what is wrong with us now? We are suffering. We are traumatized. So we need to have a healing. We're looking at economics, yes. We're looking at politics, yes. But there's this thing that binds and encapsulates this whole idea of civilization. It's called culture. In the capitalist storm of the 20th century, those who will not survive are those who have no culture. If you watch Japan, Japan is one of the most prosperous places right now. Why? They were cunning enough to take on the material advancement of the West, but still stuck to their culture.
But even their culture too is under threat as well, because Western culture is dominating quite a bit in Japan as well.
Right, it seeps through because of the younger generation.
Right. So that's the challenge, because we want to speak on behalf of...
So it starts with the schools.
Right.
On our money, we have the queen's face. On the other, we have the Golden Hind, Francis Drake's ship. So our whole society is it's actually denying who we are. Well, I should say a fraction of us, because many of us do not claim African heritage, but they are still Saint Lucians. But
Dr.
we
Dr.
are the
Junior,
ones actually.
How
suffering.
Is it still possible? We had Sir Dwight Venner. We had very brilliant people at the ECCB. Very brilliant people in politics. How is it still possible that we would probably still have the Queen on our dollar bill?
That has to do with holding on to the perceived realms of power, and how should I put it? I think that what really happens is that some people thrive on other people's ignorance. So it would be in the best interest of the minority, which holds all the wealth, to keep people ignorant. Okay? Because united you stand, divided you fall. And if you go back to, there's this book, The Willie Lynch Letter. This is a tool that was used on the plantation. Basically, the slave master would use your differences to put you against the other person. Okay, so you are light skin and that person is dark skin, you have something to fight over. And until we get past the Willie Lynch syndrome, until we realize the common good in all man, until we realize the connectedness of all living things, I do not think that we will see any real change until we understand that I am because we are. Okay, so we need to get back to that collective approach to living rather than what's in it for me solely.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I think unless these issues are addressed systematically, until the education system has been reformed, whereby you get a clearer, broader perspective of who you are, not just as a Saint Lucian, but your ethnicity and all of those things, until those issues are addressed in a real way, until we have conscious people in a position of power and influence, I'm not sure that we will get there anytime
soon. So does that mean that these conscious people now get into politics?
It may be the way. It may be the way.
It is the only
Dr.
way.
Dr. King, very quickly, before we take a break, the Queen, I'm sure, I'm probably wrong, didn't insist that we put her image on our dollar bill. But like I said, we have some, we know the thinking of Sir Dwight Venner and other persons who have led in various capacities, economic, academia, and so on, but yet still is there with us.
Mm-hmm. You see, we all of us will show the indoctrination of our minds and the cultural penetration that has almost unwittingly taken over our beings. So we will see nothing wrong, because that is it. So it's just a way of thinking. And the truth is, we have to break away from that automatic type of thinking. I think Lucius was talking about the system and the corporations. And there's some interesting books that people should read. I remember a friend of mine made me read The Economic Hitman, and there's another one called Banksters.
Mm-hmm.
And these books point out to you that the world system is actually designed to put countries like us and people like us into debt, so that we are beholden and dependent, and therefore we can then be controlled. So all of those factors are things that we need to be aware of and understand that our very thinking, the things that we want. I think Maat mentioned early that about cluttering our lives with things. We've been indoctrinated to believe that all the things that we need, whereas we haven't stopped to think, what do I truly need? Where does my happiness come from? What will make me happy? Will what I'm seeing on the television, that is the North American lifestyle or the European lifestyle, is that the lifestyle that will make me happy? Is that the kind of music that will make me happy? Or is it the music that I will generate from my own understanding? You're a musician. And you even musicians, how much are musicians influenced by what they hear from other cultures, and how much comes from the innate creativity of themselves? And more, you'll appreciate we must go back to our innate creativity. Why does Kuduro music, Denry segment music, hit the world stage like it does at this point in time? My suspicion is because it has more integrity as a music rhythm, a music beat. It has an integrity of a St. Lucian African rhythm that came out. And that I think is when I see things like that, I must tell you, I actually applaud the Denry segment Kuduro music. Mm-hmm. Right? I may not like some of the lyrics, but that's not the point. The music itself is what we're talking about. And so I think that more and more we must question all the time why we think how we think, why we make the decisions we make, and become more conscious of that. Be we leaders in our homes or leaders of the society, leaders in community. And I know we're going to a break, so I think I have more to say, but
there's a lot more. We have some time. Before we take this break, I wanted to just run a clip because I said we're going to feature from the panel discussion, so we can just kind of keep our discussion moving along as well. Let's hear from Cuthbert Didier, who made a contribution at the panel discussion, and we'll come back after that to continue our discussions right here.
And I want us to really look at ourselves in the mirror. As a nation, are we truly free? And when I say free, are we truly free in the term of a sovereign nation? Are we free to make decisions in this global imperative? I want to give a snapshot. Our economy is in challenging times. In America, herb ganja is on its way to being legal and is being sold and dispensed for medical purposes. Yet still, the great USA comes down in helicopters and tells us what to do with the very thing that's free in their country. So are we really free to make decisions as a sovereign nation?
So that's kind of the DJ. We will come back in just a few moments to continue that conversation right here on the reality show.
It's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing another song of freedom? Cause all I ever had, redemption song.
This summer, Fix is providing loans of up to $5,000 with competitive interest rates to help cover all school-related expenses, from tuition fees, school books, brand new iPads or laptops, and uniforms. Visit us at number 15 Bridge Street, Castries, or Providence Commercial Center, Rodney Bay. Telephone 458-8700 or 458-8740.
Whatever your financial needs, we've got a plan for you.
With just one click, the internet connects people, businesses, and nations. Being connected can open a world of information and opportunities. You can get services and products of your choice much faster, from electronic financial transactions to connecting with family and friends, from being up to date with the latest news and information to learning new skills and acquiring academic qualifications, all from the convenience of your home or wherever you roam. Get connected today.
This message is brought to you as a public service announcement by Ectel, the NTRC, and this station.
with the shape of you.
Welcome back to our discussion here at Calabash TV, the reality show, as we have a discussion on the discussion that took place on for Emancipation Day organized by the CDF. And we have with us Maat, also Lucius and Dr. King. We thank you for being here, helping us to advance the discussion. And like I said, we wanted to focus on the similar little things that can be done, because we know what we need to do and what has to be done. I think that has been pretty well articulated, but we want to get some simple basic things that somebody can start doing from this very minute, in terms of the emancipation that we talk about. Obviously, from what you heard, Dr. King, from what Cuthbert was saying, and also from what came out of the discussion, that we are nowhere close to the emancipation. And Bob Marley was saying about the other emancipation, or mental slavery. So there are so many different levels of emancipation that we have. How do we even start to begin that process?
Let me say what, and Lucius will know about this. From a rights point of view, what we're looking at right now is an empowerment program with community leaders. We're calling it safe spaces, but really it's about creating inspired and inspiring community leadership in the communities that we will interface with, hopefully every community in St. Lucia. So that, for example, is a small step, because if we can create the kind of community leadership which we have envisioned, that will start educating the youth. That will start the community movement in thinking more consciously, because it's all designed to have communities think about, this is a problem you have, what's your solution, and you have the power to implement the solution for your problem. So you don't have to look to somebody to give you a solution. You find a solution and you negotiate the resources that are necessary for that solution. And you may very well find that the resources are well within your grasp, because much of our problem is thinking. It's a thinking conscious problem, much more so than a resources problem, when I say than a tangible physical resource problem. So we were talking about earlier, somebody asked you, how much money do you have to contribute? If you have 5 cents, 5 cents is the beginning. You can start with a 5 cents. So that is an example. So that is one place to start. Of course, the other obvious place to start is the school, the education curriculum and the teachers. We need a curriculum and we need teachers that interface with our children in an empowering way, not the manner in which the school system is presently being run, with the curriculum just presently being run. So both the content and the process of education in the schools, in my view, needs to change as a matter of urgency. But I do appreciate that one is not within the power of an organization such as RISE. Mm-hmm. All we can do in that case is advocate for it.
So Maat, this is where the society needs to take up the mantle in terms of what RISE is doing in other organizations, because I think Dr. King also mentioned reform. We've had an attempt to reform our constitution, and we're not quite sure where that is going. And we've had an attempt to get a vision statement made defined for St. Lucia, and that hasn't quite happened as yet. When you see those developments, how encouraged are you that something can be done by doing more of what we're doing?
Well, it seems in the 20th century, starting from the birth of the of capitalism, from that feudal system in Europe, it seems that everything starts out good. We have the intention, but it just disappears. It dissipates and nothing happens. Why is that? It is because we do not nurture that feminine principle. We do not nurture. We need to be able to, because you can say you want to do something, but that vital force that will have you doing it, that power comes from the subconscious. So we need to be nurturing whatever you want to do. You can't just tell somebody to change their life today, tomorrow. You have to nurture the experience. The media make farming look good. Show some beautiful women farming. Show the youths that farming, husbandry, you're married to the land firstly. It's your survival. How can we say we're free when someone else is feeding us? And we see from capitalism you have monopolization. So you have different corporations coming, buy out the competition, and then their word is law. and the government now have to yield to whatever corporation or whatever hotel. But what I'm saying is that, take a look around. Why do they call the Caribbean paradise? It's because we have sun 364 days a year, 65 days and a quarter a year. That's why. So agriculture should be the main, we don't have to grow bananas alone. So many things. I always say that it's been over 1,000 years since we knew ourselves. I'm talking about the time of the Moors, because it was the Moors that educated and gave European civilization after they fell after the Roman Empire. So in our history, it's so rich and so full of jewels we can apply to our lives today. But we need the Ministry of Education. The Minister of Education needs to look into all these negative forces which are being planted in the minds of the children. Now the children represent the future. I walk in town, I pass around, I see a lot of people. They have become so capitalistic. It has seeped into their very pores. They would come, put a tray, and what they would be selling?
Conkles.
Lollipop, conkles, chewing gum. All these things that you would tell your children at home, don't buy that. Or you would try and tell them, just buy one, because you know of the damage.
But what do you tell those people? Because they are basically doing this for their own economic survival.
Uh-huh.
And they would ask you, what are my options?
So that's what Bob Marley said. The day would come and we would fight each other to eat a bread. Why is money so important? Money is only important is because we're not united. This is why we give money this grand, but it shows that there is something missing. The glue that holds a community and a civilization together is a culture. We should have a cultural explosion in St. Lucia. The government needs to come on board. The cultural departments need to come on board. The different organizations need to start busting out. It is the only time after 1,000 years that we can search and find out who we are, because we have the internet. The internet has all the information, but we are not guided to the right people to go to. So because I focus a lot on the youth, that's why I tutor the youth, because it's the only way I can be in the present and reach out into the future. I have to get into their minds. I have to build them up. I have to tell them about the great heroes we ignore of not too far, the Caribbean. Walter Rodney, C.L.R. James, Henry Sylvester Williams, Eric Williams, Sir Arthur Lewis, Marcus Garvey, George Padmore, Blyden. There's so many we can give to them. But who do they have? Vibes Cartel.
Alkaline.
But they're still Caribbean people. They are Caribbean heroes.
Yes, but what message are they bestowing?
So how do you influence like the Vibes Cartel, Alkaline? How do you influence those guys? Because they're very powerful in terms of communicating to our youth.
Well, you see, these guys have already been brainwashed into the same capitalistic idea that life is about profit.
About self.
So if Marcus Garvey didn't have influence on a Jamaican artist, what hope is there for a Senegalese artist?
It's a good question. But I think, as I was saying, is the experience of being nurtured. When you look around, you see posters. When you look around, you see adults carrying on in a decent way. When you walk in town, you see drunkards. We are developing a society of drunkards. The Prime Minister right now has established more partying in the country on a yearly basis. So we have this rum culture that is brewing, and we see murders, we see death. Most murders happen under the intoxication of alcohol, not marijuana. So where are the truth seekers? Why do everybody hide? Because they need to build their house. They need to pay their vehicle. These are all things that do not really actually build civilization.
Lucius, out of that reality, where does the inspiration come from?
Well, again, it has to go back to the value system and the nurturing.
But somebody has to establish that value system.
Yeah, well, it starts with the power of one, you mm-hmm. know. If the best way to teach somebody is by example, mm-hmm. you know, and that's another problem that we have. We have teachers, people in positions of influence saying one thing and doing another. Mm-hmm, you mm-hmm. know, some might look at the excuse that's in the Bible and say, well, do as they say, but not as they do. But how practical is that? You know, actions speak louder than words. Mm-hmm. So again, the value system and being responsible as an individual is where it starts. You know, it starts with the power of one, mm-hmm. you know. And of course, as we look at the nurturing aspect and we're working with young people, we have to instill proper values, because the decisions that any decision that you make in life would stem from your values, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. A tree without roots is dead. So we need to get in touch with historical fact about who we are, how we lived. We also need to showcase the great civilizations that we had prior to slavery. Okay? And more importantly, death to the ego. Because the ego is only about me and what can I get from it. We had to think about those coming. We had to think about whether or not we want to live in an environment where we have to hide behind you know what, gated communities, because it's gotten so bad. We become so selfish that we don't realize that if we do not stop for a minute to look at the nurturing of each other, that is going to be ultimate chaos.
You see, I think, not to stop you, but mm-hmm. I think that many are interested in putting a plaster. No one is interested in going to the root of the issue. And it ultimately lies in the education system.
Absolutely.
It ultimately, and also, you cannot divorce our situation and where we are right now to this Europeanized Christianity which we have inherited from our foreparents. It holds you, it binds you in a box. You do not have freedom of thought. You're asked to believe and never to know. Your emotions are played on. Your great-great-grandparents were waiting for a certain man. He never came. You are to come right now in this time and still await this certain man to come. And that will never happen. You know? So we really need to wake up. And as you ask the question, you should hold up that mirror in front of your face and ask that question. What can we do? No, what can I do? Take a few children. We rely on the education system to educate them. Why are they not teaching us our history? It's 2017. Why is this happening? Have you made the effort to learn your history and bestow it on your children? Mm-hmm. Why do you depend on others to teach your children the truth? And despite of what is the foundation of the capitalist system, which is everyone having their own truth, this is an error. There is only one truth. There are many opinions. So to get back to that source of truth, we have to get back to live for the glory of culture and not for the profit of the dollar.
Okay. We want to get back to the panel just first to get a sense of what was actually said there. And there was somebody representing the youth, Toyla Lagon. She has studied economics and political science. And so she made a few comments, and we want to just take a little excerpt from some of what she said, so we can follow on from there. So here's Tyler Lagon.
From the UNWTO organization, they highlight that from 1990 to 2015, increases in tourism for the Caribbean, they have been slow and steady. So we go from 11% international arrivals to 23% in the span of, say, 20 years almost. And that's just 12% growth in income from tourism. So we need to look at how much that is bringing to us and why that is the case. And that for me would have to be that we're too focused on hotel tourism. There are many aspects of tourism that we need to look into, but there's just been a focus on the sun and sea sort of destination, which is on the decline. And rightfully so, it is on a decline because time times are changing, and we need dynamic structures, structures that are able to flex with the coming age. We have the growth of the millennials. Millennials tend to be independent persons, and when you study their behavioral habits and travel patterns, they tend to not use hotels. They use the Airbnb. They don't want to go according to various tour, given tour guides, etc. They want to do it on their own. They hire what you call Uber, which is, you know, your taxi services to here and back. So if this is the new age of persons coming into being and being economically active, then the platform that we're trying to still invest in, we're still investing in hotels, we're still investing in the cruise tourism, that is not technically helping us.
She spoke on behalf of the youth, and she also is a student of economics and political science. So we'll get a discussion on that in just a minute. We'll take a short break and then come back to continue the conversation.
This is The Reality Show. We welcome all viewpoints and perspectives. Keep it pointed, original, and constructive.
Of Chemical Bleach, St. Lucia's very own locally produced bleach, are excited to announce its brand new look for 2017. The public is hereby informed that the old Chemical Bleach labels have been swapped for new ones. The chemical you've come to use and love over the years has not changed. It's only now available under a new and more attractive packaging. Chemical Bleach is available at all shops and supermarkets island-wide. Keep that sparkle in your clean with Chemical Bleach.
Y'all doing out there? Y'all playing the fool, not football. Justin, what are you thinking passing the ball to Kelly? I don't even know why you on the team. That's the worst team I've ever coached. Get out of my sight.
Carl, that was wrong. Those players don't deserve that, especially Kelly. What you say to them on this field can affect them for life.
Okay, I get it. All right? I get the point.
Words don't break bones, but they can damage lives.
Come on! Yeah, that's it! Come on! That's what I'm talking about! Yeah.
Together, let's end emotional abuse, on or off the field. If you hear something, say something.
Good game, guys. Sorry I shouted during the break. I was wrong.
A message from UNICEF and the OECS.
This is Our Reality, Calabash TV.
Calabash TV, and we heard before the break from Toyla Lagon. And Dr. King, you wanted to add very quickly.
Yes, I have to agree with Toyla. I think she's, and that's what I was getting at. Let us define a tourism industry that works for us and actually works for the market that is trending, or works for our market that we can trend with, mm-hmm. which what she was talking about. And I think that's so important that we allow new ideas, new ways of doing things. But to make that change, it takes a lot of confidence. You see, especially older people, the system controllers, those that have the capital and those that have the means, we tend to be a little bit more traditional. And what has worked in the past is we don't want to change. That's a hard thing for us to do. So to embrace the idea of what a young person like her is putting out, somebody might say, oh no, we can't do that. Hotels are what works, right? But comes back to us having, as a people, having that confidence with, based on our identity and our consciousness, to say, you know something, we're working together on this, and I'm with that young person, and I agree with her, and I think we can invest and we can make this thing happen, as she's saying, because I can see, because I have that consciousness, and my mind is open to understand what she is saying and embrace and move. So I think I like that.
Mm-hmm. So Lucius, it has to be like a transition, because it's true, if we cannot move away from this brick and mortar immediately, mm-hmm. But we need to gradually do it. But in the meantime, people have the needs, and and I think when Dr. King mentioned that the persons who work at those hotels and so on, how do you speak with them to convince them that, listen, we need to make that transition from this brick and mortar, but within that transition, what do we do in the meantime?
Well, again, I would have to highlight the fact we need stronger communities. Okay, I think Dr. King also alluded to that. We need stronger communities, and with the empowerment of civil society, what you have is the confidence that there are people behind you. Okay, people that believe in you.
Well, how long would it take for you to empower that civil society?
Well, that I'm not too certain of, but I think that it can be done. And that's the most important thing. So you may make small steps, but you move it in the right direction. So I think that's, it's worthwhile. You understand? I mean, to go forward, to be quite honest, we need holistic learning, holistic health. You know, we need to see things from a multifaceted way, and how we are in tune with those things. Okay, unless we don't understand who we are, where we're coming from, we may never really and truly know where to go or how to go about it. But again, I will come back to the point, we need to understand who we are. We must have an identity of self. And a lot of us, we don't really know who we are.
Maat, can civil society and the political system coexist? Can we have both?
Yes, we can have both. But it has to be a change of thing, a different paradigm. Because, as she said, tourism is a way of making money. In a civilization, there exist three aspects: the cultural, the political, and the economics. Now, we need to analyze that the corporations that come and set up in St. Lucia, are we giving them work? Are we letting them come in for jobs? Is it only for jobs? How much the... Okay, we have hotels. They pay the fortnight or monthly, they pay the workers. The worker would take their money. They would go to Massey, okay? They would go to Hobby. The people that are getting empowered in this system in St. Lucia are not the majority of the people who are the African people. So we see that the factors of production are slowly being taken for a specific groups of people who are the ones who keep to themselves. All minorities in St. Lucia keep to themselves, and they have a preserved culture. It is only the African St. Lucian who has no culture and thinks he can mix with everyone. He doesn't have the mind of nationness, of nation building. It is better when you get paid, you go to the corner store. You try your best to get from those who would use your money, you would pay them in the community. Before that money leaves the island, it would turn over a number of times. Then they're getting paid by the hotels, the majority of the money which would leave the island. The only thing that would stay, I gather, would be the taxes, which I think they have little tax to pay.
The
customs, but which is, they don't have to pay. So the money that is only bestowed is the salaries in the pockets of the people, which actually live in the different major holdings of the minorities who I see not contributing a thing to our development. How much money does the government give Chiriki every month? A million? Almost a million? Why is there not anyone to inspire the people to work for themselves, to build buildings, to house our governments for themselves? Why is there a price tag on everything? It is a Eurocentric way of living, a Eurocentric view of life, of using people and loving things. This is what we have to get away from. This is why I have taken on myself to tutor children for nothing at all. Just trying to make that change and make that difference. And if we all have that mindset, we can go so far. But there are things that hinder us. One of the things that hinder us is our mates. We need to choose who we have children with, who we put up our lives with. If the mission is a unified people, be with someone on that same mission. Don't look for anyone who would stray you from that most detrimental. We wait until our backs are against the wall, but we have to realize it's a very important time in our history. And history will verify and vilify the people who look to take self-accountability and choose to make that much-needed difference in the minds of the people, and then it would transcend down to our actions, the love and respect we show for each other, our women, our children. The whole concept of God has to do with community. It is only the European thinks of me and I reaching to heaven. The African thinks of his community and his family salvation.
You know, I wanted to come to this model of tourism, and because it's on the table, what Ms. Lagon put on for us, and why there will be a certain amount of resistance to that type of tourism. That type of tourism is not very capital intense, because if I put up, I create a room in my house where I can rent out from Airbnb, and I can go on social media and market. And people will come and stay there, and the food will come from the local community and so on for me and that tourist in that house, and I will take, or I will declare tours within our community and where we, and so on and so forth. That is not a very capital intense form of tourism, but of course the hotels are capital intense. So we've been led to believe that you must have a lot of capital to be involved in the tourism industry, and if you don't have the capital, you cannot be involved. This other model says differently. Now, we're in an era now of information, connectivity, technology. So we're in an information now where facilitation, which is a word that Lucius uses, facilitation for low capital type tourism in our country, which is better for us and is the type of tourism you would think we should be promoting, rather than in moving more into thinking about 2,000 hotel rooms as being 2,000 hotel rooms in big high-rise structures. Right. Take, for instance, with the Grass Street community and the Derek Walcott project. Why is it that you cannot have a Grass Street cooperative that has a tourism product where there people can come and stay? There's a Derek Walcott museum. Everybody in Grass Street benefits from that tourism product that they have defined in a community cooperative. Why? Couldn't we do that? And what would be the cost of us having to do that? Would a tourist want to come and stay in that particular community? Why not? Especially if they felt that community was safe and it was the kind of experience that they were looking for. So I think that what she's put on the table causes us all to change how we think. And I like what Maat said about spending your money in your own community and letting your money multiply in your country. Our consciousness at the level of our macroeconomic situation must be, how do we keep our blood, if for want of a better word, in our bodies? How do we keep our money in our country rather than bleeding it? Let it multiply here than multiply elsewhere. And I think it would be really nice to see government, back to politicians now, to see governments, the technocrats and the politicians in government, doing budgets which facilitated that type of economic growth. Absolutely. With those kinds of policies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Lucius.
Yeah, I have a question, basically. when you know, the government talks about tourism, who are they thinking of? Really and truly, who are they really thinking of? Are they thinking about the people, or are they thinking about the investors like Bush Stewart and these guys? What's the end result from tourism? What's the average salary that somebody working in the hospitality industry? What's the average salary of a worker in the hospitality industry? So when you talk about tourism, who are you thinking of? Are you thinking about the arrivals, or are you thinking about your people benefiting wholly from tourism? That's a question that I think needs to be addressed.
I would try to answer that question, but I think when speaking of the politics and the politicians regarding tourism and who actually benefits, you have to go back to learn the system that politics work under. Mm. Politics work under, you invest money, you run for a seat, you try to make that money back, you try and build a condo, you try to get a boat, it's all about them lining their pockets. Now, If you come in a seat and you have only 5 years, certain things you will want to rub shoulders with the elite. After your job ends, you worry about after you leave the leadership role. Will all the other corporations which you helped, will they help you? So it has to do with, I think, a personal gain rather than seen. Because if you were watching the end, everyone in St. Lucia, then you would realize that we're not lacking. Sir Arthur Lewis did write something on surplus labor. Mm-hmm. The capitalist system should keep at a balance or evenness with our agricultural sector. And you would draw workers to the capitalist system from the agricultural sector. So that means agriculture would be basic knowledge. Each school should have a farm catering for their needs. Each school should have a farm catering for their needs. I think they started that project, but I don't know where it went.
And that's part of our issue, because we have those ideas, I think, what somebody mentioned earlier on, but it's not sustained, it's not continued. But we want to move on as well. Dr. Keng, you were there. So one of the issues that came up as well was the question of reparations.
Yeah.
And I think a question was posed to one of the panelists, Tedus Preville, about his thoughts on it. And I wanted to play that clip so we can have a discussion from there as well.
Emancipation, we know with emancipation there was compensation paid to the planters. The Africans were never compensated. I would like the panelists to speak on what they think about the role of reparations in terms of economic freedom on the whole, and also for African people in St. Lucia.
My views may be very, very left. I don't believe in reparations. I don't believe anybody owes me anything in life. I believe where I am is where I am. And where I am, I move from where I am. I believe if I'm going to wait for Europe, I know the history. I know what was done to us. I cannot undo that. What I have to do is to move forward. So I am not waiting for any form of reparation. I do, however, recognize that when you talk about reparations, sometimes we see reparation as an economic. If you look at an accounting structure, you would see if you put reparation there and someone gives you whatever millions, whatever it is, they give you a one-time lump sum. So here is your reparation. Share it among you. Finish a few. I'm not interested in that. I'm more interested in engaging the people who, through their efforts in the past, have me here, engaging them in a manner that gives me not a one-time payment, but a future of continuous income. Meaning, I engage you, we work, we trade, and I get my reparation that way. I am I'm more interested in sitting down with you and saying, here are the areas I want you to work with me in my economy, on different areas, that's where I get my reparation. But reparation as a payment, not interested.
Lucius, do you share those thoughts?
Some of it. Mm-hmm. Well, I want to say most of it. I am interested in reparations, and not necessarily the lump sum like he was alluding to, but in terms of the social fabric, investing in social development programs, investing in skills training for our people, that's the type of reparations that I'm very interested in. And also anything that could help us develop ourselves and take full control of our future, whether it be through cash or kind, I'm definitely interested in that type of reparation.
Maat, I know it's probably something you've given a lot of thought, certainly.
Of course, yes, I have. The issue of reparations. Of course, reparations begins with the mind. You have to go back to your center and put priority in your life, know what's important. In regards to his statement, like Lucia said, I agree with him to a point. Yes, we should get payment. Payment not necessarily in money, because your money would be spent according to your priorities. What things we look forward to are a change in the exams like the CXC, because we want to change the education system, but we still have Eurocentric exams. So we need to go into the whole structure, you know. But this requires some brave, knowledgeable, intellectual leaders who, at the crossroads of time, can read the signboards of the past. This is what we need. And we are not, we don't have leaders who are aware of our history, our heroes, what took part in the 50s, well, the late 50s and the 60s in Africa, when all the different nations were looking to govern themselves. Quite interesting things happened. Men were able to use religion to free themselves. We can get a lot of information, a lot of courage, a lot of jewels from our ancestors. So I really think it's the education system we will have to look into in terms of reparations. And money, I think they should wipe out that IMF debt. Because if in regards to speak on the IMF is a totally different show.
Yeah, I suppose that's a different
how the IMF
yes.
has destroyed countries all over the world.
But the IMF will tell you that you can't blame the doctor. If there's someone, and Dr. King would know, if a situation is cancerous, you can, and it's too late, you can't blame the doctor for that. But like you say, it's a discussion we need to have.
Again, cancer is reversible.
Yes. Dr. King, the two things that came out so far, reform of the education system and a dearth, apparently, in leadership. Now, we saw what has happened with our constitutional reform. How confident are you that we can actually even pursue reform?
Constitutional reform?
Well, education in the education system. Forget the constitution for now.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That is such a hard question to answer, Bunan, because on the one hand, I think it's so easy to do education reform because the children want it. I speak to children in schools all the time and they want a reformed education system. Parents want a reformed education system. Those of us who even think about the society and where it's going want a reformed education system.
But even the minister as well has said that we need a reform. So why isn't
why
it happening?
Why doesn't it happen?
So
that's my problem.
Make it happen?
I don't understand if everybody wants it and it doesn't happen. Why? And the only thing I can come up with is we lack the confidence to make the change. We lack the confidence to say, let's break away from this system and let us design our own system and reform our system as we think it should be. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's because we lack the consciousness, we lack the confidence to break the new ground and from a new type of education system. Although I think that's such a, if you think about it, it's so, the minister herself or the permanent secretary or the chief education officer, I'm sure that they themselves could understand it would not be such a great transgression to move from where it is now to what it should be. Mm-hmm. So I'm, in fact, this is one thing I'm really looking forward to. Mm-hmm. I really want to see a reformed education system. I really think that the government has the power to do it, has the willingness of the people to implement a new system. So I think they should just go do it. Mm-hmm. By the next financial year, they should already be giving CAMDU the orders to change the curriculum, right? We have connections to the CXC people. Maat mentioned about CXC. Mm-hmm. Let us go to CXC and tell CXC, sorry, we are changing this. And I know that throughout the islands, people want CXC to change as well. So I think it's just a matter of that tipping point, to reach that tipping point to have the will to do it. I wanted to say though on the reparations, listening to Titus was interesting because he resonates with some of the things that we've been saying here to a certain extent, in that the healing comes from within us. We cannot look to Europeans to heal us. We have to heal ourselves first. Now, he makes the next point that as a healed people, knowing who we are, where we are, and where we want to go, we can now negotiate with these former slave masters and tell them, you know what I would like though? If it's one thing I truly want, is a recognition. A clear statement from all these nations that they exploited the Caribbean, they exploited St. Lucia, they built their wealth on the backs and the blood of our people. And that needs to be recognized. Even if no money is given, but that recognition must be made. Absolutely. Because that's important for us to heal as well. And they must understand that the dehumanizing is the real issue. and the fact that the dehumanization continues. Look at Black Lives Matter and look at what's happening to African Americans in the United States. Look at when you go out on this world, into the European world, into the white universities, and you stand up and speak, they don't expect much from you, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. We are often seen as lesser peoples, mm-hmm. right? And that is from a hangover from that dehumanization. Even when we come to the negotiating table, they often look at us, well, you know, look at those people. You know, like we are inferior peoples, right? And we even accept that. And I think that, for me, is the kernel of the reparation. That, look, first we accept that we are equal. We have the confidence to stand on our own 2 feet. We can do it on our own. And secondly, they must recognize that fact too. And then, of course, we can now work in partnership, mm-hmm. in a genuine partnership, not a hand-me-down dependent relationship, right? And it boggles my mind that we don't understand the value of our St. Lucia and ourselves on this global stage. We undersell all the time. And we are selling ourselves out all the time. And I think because of this inferiority complex which we seem to have perpetrated on ourselves.
I think Lucius wanted to make a quick point before we take a break. Yes.
I just wanted to put it in a local context. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to highlight how religion has done that to us as a people. You understand? Because at one point in time, Rastafarians were not allowed to go to schools. And until we don't get past that and become an inclusive society where the Rastaman and the Catholic, the Pentecostal, the Methodist, the Church of God, until we see each other as equal, I think we'll always have that same issue on a local scale.
Okay. That's what I want to say. We'll take a break here, but I'll tease the next segment, and we have about 15 minutes left on the show. And Dr. King, you were there, so you saw the emotional bit there from Jomo.
I did.
I'll play a little piece of it, and then we'll come back and have a discussion on that as we wrap up our conversation. Right.
That we need to be critical of ourselves, especially our generation, who are so privileged. And now that we have escaped from poverty and from all the rest of it, and we are PSCs and different this and different that, we forget where we came from. And the problem lies with us.
Our reality, Calabash TV.
This summer, Fix is providing loans of up to $5,000 with competitive interest rates to help cover all school-related expenses, from tuition fees, school books, brand new iPads or laptops, and uniforms. Visit us at number 15 Bridge Street, Castries, or Providence Commercial Center, Rodney Bay. Telephone 458-8700 or 458-8740.
Whatever your financial needs, we've got a plan for you.
The manufacturers of chemical bleach, St. Lucia's very own locally produced bleach, are excited to announce its brand new look for 2017. The public is hereby informed that the old chemical bleach labels have been swapped for new ones. The chemical you've come to use and love over the years has not changed. It's only now available under a new and more attractive packaging. Chemical bleach is available at all shops and supermarkets island-wide. Keep that sparkle in your clean with chemical bleach.
Welcome back to The Reality Show. And we just featured before the break a clip from Jomo, who was at the panel discussion organized by the Cultural Development Foundation on Emancipation. And we wanted to play just a little piece of his contribution. And you might see a question after it, because I was hoping to get other questions involved. But we will focus mainly on Jomo's contribution.
That we need to be critical of ourselves, especially our generation, who are so privileged. And now that we have escaped from poverty and from all the rest of it, and we are PSCs and different this and different that, we forget where we came from. And the problem lies with us. The house Negroes have a very important role. They are supposed to be hearing the secrets of the masters and feed us outside so that we can continue the revolution. And what we're seeing is that the house Negroes are not playing their role.
Politics has killed St. Lucia and has killed our youth. Our youth are like wild grass with no leadership. Mr. Percival was saying we need to find out what our identity is. It's always been there. It's never left us. I think the politicians have moved away from it. And one of the things that they need to start doing is going back to the people.
So, Dr. King, are the so-called house Negroes and the politicians the common enemy?
Well, like Jomo says, in days gone by, the house Negro was an important person for the field Negro to bring the information, the information from the masters, so that almost like, for want of a better word, the soothsayer role, you would come and you would let the people know what is happening, what's coming down, so they could know how to conduct their whatever activity, be it a revolution or whatever, to burn which cane field and when. So that is what he was talking about. But as he says, when the house Negro has forgotten where they have come from, and they leave the field Negroes, the masses, out there, and they no longer see themselves as connected to, and they no longer see themselves as being responsible to sharing information with and uplifting the status of the others, that's when there's a problem. I think that's what, to me, that's what I was getting from what he was saying. Mm-hmm. And in his context now, the house Negro happens to be our civil servants, and of course those who have made it. And he's saying, and I think it's a valid point. It's a spiritual point to a certain extent, that you have made it. But because you have made it, you actually now have a responsibility to look and say, I know where I come from. I am one of you. I am you. And let me see what I can do to uplift you as well. That is what he's saying. And I agree with him. I think it's important for every one of us who lives on this beautiful island to see what we can do to uplift and unify everybody in this island. We cannot create equality, we know that. We cannot by overnight, but we know that we can start making those small steps towards creating a better life for each and every one. And that is what he's getting at. And when he says about the battle that we need to engage, I believe that is the battle that he wants us to engage, which is what I think in this panel we've been talking about. The traditional capitalist model is one of winner take all. And that is not the model, or that is one model of it. That is not the model that we can go forward with in our country. We need a different model. So that's what I took from him. And I respect Jomo a lot. There was one other thing he told me, which I like very much, by the way, which I have to share with the panel. He said, you know, we're talking about something else, though, and I'll always remember this. So he said, there are two things in life, principles and privilege. He says, I'll tell you what, I will never compromise my principles for privilege. Because the day I compromise my principle for privilege, I lose both. And I thought that was excellent. And that is a message for the house Negroes as well.
Maat, we want to get some of your final thoughts as we wrap up this discussion here.
Okay. Speaking in the spirit of revolution, we need not look far back. We can remember the first of the independent countries in the Western world, Haiti. And we look at what they did. They went back to the African roots. They put away the white god. You build the self-esteem and the confidence of a people. And then it will work, it will just take off. Because the human beings right now are searching for a purpose. This is the time. This is the time where we look more to they say right brain than left brain. Less academia, more arts, more the authenticity, more, you know, creativity. This is where the world is going. That's why with the plantations by the sea don't really pull the tourists anymore. Because the tourists want to see, what do you create from your environment? How has this, the world environment, the capitalist environment, how has it affected you? Or have you survived? Have you held on to your culture? Are you still, do you still stand for truth? Do you still stand for the environment? You know? So we need to not have a physical battle, bloodshed. I think that is the last resort. We need to have some conversations with the elites, have some direct conversation. If they don't want to come, we protest and we make them come to the table. They need to hear us and they need to heed truth. I want to say also, even though that we try to put off the violence, we must also remember that the tree of freedom is usually watered by the blood of a generation. And also, I want to appeal to women. We neglect the fact of the power a woman holds in manifesting the way civilization behaves. I usually say that the hand that rocks the cradle usually sways the destiny of a nation. But within saying that, we are still living a patriarchal system where the women keep quiet and men enforce women to keep quiet and their voices are not heard. We need to empower the women, because men argue because of the ego. Women get things done. We need to empower them, because many revolutions were started by women. The Virgin Islands, we have the three women. We have women in Africa. We have Nzinga. We have Muhumusa. We have Queen Kahina. We have so many. We need to give them back what's theirs, their history. They need it. It's important. They are dying because of a lack of it.
And we do have one important hero as well. I think Peter Floor was named after a brigand, female,
yes.
Who led brilliantly, I understand, in battle. So we do have our
in
heroes
Saint Lucia,
as well.
Yeah. Our own female.
And
yes.
I learned recently
hero.
That Peter Floor was named after her, because I know Peter Floor very well. I didn't know the story behind that. Mm-hmm. And that means the same thing we're talking about. We need to know the history.
Exactly.
Lucius, as you wrap up.
Well, as I wrap up, true emancipation starts with knowledge of self. You know, I think that we should look within to find the God within and operate with that God. And no matter your religion or your faith, there is that common thread enshrined within every religion, you know, love for humanity, love for your neighbor. So I'm appealing to my fellow Christians, religious people, spiritual people, to find a love for each other. You know, we need holistic health and holistic learning. We need to understand, we need to be in tune with the cosmos. We need to understand what black light is, how it affects us, how it helps us. You know, we need to know about Sirius B. We need to learn about our ancestors, the Dogons, these people that actually could map out the heavens and inculcated within their civilizations and their societies. When it was time for irrigation, we have lost that knowledge of self. So we're like a feather in the wind.
Lucius Doctor Jone is a human resource development specialist. Well, thank you for being here with us.
Yes.
And also was our hero Maat, who's the St. Lucia Chaplain for the European World Federation.
Mm-hmm, yes.
We want to thank you and very, very quickly explain to us the symbol that you have here. I know you brought it for a particular purpose as well.
Well, this I create. I create many woodwork just to bring back this, because our brains operate basically on imagery, not words. Mm-hmm. And words tell a million stories. This is from the Merakut, or we would call it the pyramids. This is the representation of, they call it Osiris' back, or I should say the spine. Because on the spine holds the chakras, the vortexes of energy. And these are the top four, which is from the heart, the throat, the pineal, and the crown. So this represents stability. It's called the Jed. The Jed, then you have the Ankh. The Ankh represents life. These are actually words. The Ankh represents divine eternal life, which is, of course, without any opposite. There is no opposite to life. Death is the opposite of both, which are both part of life. So you have this, the womb, the children, and the phallus of the man, or the penis. And you also have the woman here, the womb, the ovaries, and the birth canal. And you also have the man here, the prostate, the testes, and the penis. It also goes into the whole rejuvenation, not only of the soul, but of every living thing, the cycle of life. This here, of course, is the Was scepter. It means power. It's usually the head of an animal called, they refer to as Set. It basically talks about your lower nature and how you are to control and subdue it. Mostly your passions and your desires, not aligned with truth. So it actually means stability in life is power.
Mahat, we really appreciate this education, and we hope to have a few more of those discussions with you as well. And Dr. King, as usual, like I said, you need no introduction, and I suppose you need no conclusion either. We appreciate your input, and we certainly will have an ongoing dialogue. I mean, you certainly want to know a lot more about the project that you have with RISE, and I'm sure we'll hear a lot more about it as well. And as we leave, I leave with music, and we've incorporated a little bit of Bob Marley's Redemption song, which we normally hear on December Day. We should be hearing it throughout the year. Yeah. And musicians from around the world came together to be part of this compilation of this rendering of Bob Marley's Redemption song. So please just a little bit of it as we end the show. Again, thank you very much for being here. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Won't you hear me sing another song of freedom? It's all I ever had. Redemption song, yes, Lord. Redemption song. Redemption song. That song of freedom, yeah. It's all I ever had. Oh, yeah. Redemption song. Yes, Lord. Redemption song. Redemption song. Redemption song.
This is The Reality Show.